Hello, everybody. I am here to talk to you about Numenera. This is my official review of Monte Cook's Numenera. Full disclosure, I have known Monte for almost 20 years. He's a friend of mine, and I was a rules developer on this book, so I may be a little biased, but I wanted to talk about the setting and the rules of Monte's new game. First of all, the core of it is that it is a billion years in the future. Not necessarily exactly 1 billion years, but it is a significant advancement of time from the current time to the campaign setting. And the idea is that there have been 8 previous worlds before the world of the campaign setting, the 9th world. These are not literally like, oh, we're building a new planet or moving to another planet, but the idea is that over time, civilizations have risen and fallen and have developed just super technology that can terraform the planet, perhaps readjust the alignment of the sun to compensate for some, you know, catastrophic event. It's crazy-ass super level technology that we probably can't even conceive of right now. Anti-gravity, teleportation, anything like that. These civilizations have risen and then have either fallen, perhaps due to conflict, or they moved on to another world, or they went to explore different dimensions, anything like that. Point is, there have been 8 of those previously, and now the characters are in the 9th world, which is built on the ruins and leftovers of these previous 8 worlds. Now, what makes this really interesting as a setting is that it allows the GM to have weird artifacts from previous worlds that aren't so strange that you couldn't easily explain them to a PC, or that you could not easily explain them to a player. For example, it's entirely possible that the PCs discover a treasure trove that is really just a few shipping crates full of ballpoint pens, and they are able to figure out, oh, this is something that you write with. And perhaps they take it to a person who has knowledge of technology in the 9th world, they're a historian and a researcher of some sort, and they figure out how these things are made, and so the village where you take these and you sell them becomes known for having these really easy to use writing devices. Another village might have technology that allows you to have little extending robot legs, you can wade through swampy areas, or low-grade, almost telepathic-level radio transmitters embedded in your skull. Just any sort of weird technology that you want to be common in a particular area can. And if it falls into the hands of the PCs, that's part of your campaign. So it's a billion years in the future, and you might be wondering, well, how are humans still on the Earth if it's been a billion years? And the answer is, these aren't necessarily people that are genetically descended in a long living line from modern day people. Perhaps one of the previous worlds evolved beyond humanity and became energy beings and left, and then a subsequent race came back to the Earth or visited the Earth for the first time, saw these artifacts of humanity and decided to go and genetically engineer their own human-like race to replace it, or to make servitors that were in the shape and form of humans. Perhaps they could have done a Jurassic Park sort of thing and found a DNA residue of various humans and recreate the human race. The real definition of what is human is very flexible in the 9th world. Basically anything that is sort of a PC appropriate sort of humanity, that's human. It doesn't matter if you are genetically 100% human, or if you are genetically engineered, or if you're a synthetic creature that is kind of like a Battlestar Galactica Cylon, and that you physically resemble a human, you might have some sort of exceptional ability. It doesn't matter. You're basically a human character. The setting also has the possibility of having extraterrestrials, which might be extraterrestrial creatures that were brought here as part of some alien invasion. They could be degenerate offspring of intelligent extraterrestrials. They could be terraforming living agents of extraterrestrials. Any sort of thing you could think of. Likewise, there could be what Monte calls ultra-terrestrials, which are things that are not necessarily from a different place in space, but perhaps are from another dimension. And so you could have weird alien invaders that, in modern parlance and myth, you would consider them demons or angels or some sort of weird other universally creature. But they have come to the Earth, perhaps they are stranded here, perhaps they are visitors, perhaps they are imprisoned here, any sort of things you want to do with the campaign. It gives you a lot to work with between the various creatures that have evolved naturally on the Ninth World, that may have been genetically engineered or built by a previous civilization for a particular purpose on that world. If you heard that, that was one of the cats meowing. Hi, cat. So created for a specific purpose on the Eighth World or a previous world, and now have been left to evolve and grow on their own, or they could be aliens, or the result of weird mutation from strange technology. Another interesting aspect of the setting is that it swallows Clark's law that any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. So if you have a supercomputer, perhaps a defense supercomputer for a country, or a nation, global power in a previous world that is sentient and has the ability to reshape the environment in its vicinity, it's entirely possible that there is a village or a group of intelligent creatures, whether human or inhuman, that has grown up around the hub of this robotic intelligence, and they worship it as a god. And there's no reason to actually say that that thing isn't a god, because whether you're talking about a spiritual or supernatural entity that has the ability to alter reality around itself, or a robot that has nanites at its command that can reshape somebody's flesh, or create energy beams out of thin air, that is basically godlike. Similar rules apply to the PCs. If you are a player character in Numenera, you fall into one of three categories. The first is the glaive. They are the kind of the martial, the warrior type. The second is the nano. They are the people who have either some sort of instinctive awareness of what is called the Numenera, which is a general term for all the technology, the super science, anything like that in the Ninth World is called Numenera. If you are a nano, then you either have an instinctive understanding of how the Numenera works, or you have studied enough of it that you can manipulate it to your will. You might be some sort of cyborg that has subdermal implants that allow you to control aspects of the Numenera. Likewise, if your glaive character doesn't have to be your typical barbarian, you could be somebody who is a cyborg with, an adamantine skeleton, or your joints have been replaced with mechanisms, or you have nanobots in your bloodstream that rapidly repair your damaged tissue and augment your physical and mental reactions. Any sort of crazy explanation you want to have for your character pretty much is a possibility for your Numenera character. So we have glaives, we have nanos. The third type of character is called a jack, which in some ways is a hybrid between a glaive and a nano, in that they have some martial capability and some ability to manipulate the Numenera. But jacks also tend to be the more skill-oriented sort of characters. So one of the things that they've been repeating about Numenera is the concept that when you describe your character, you say, I am a blank blank who blanks. And that's actually, I am an adjective noun who verbs. And you might have any sort of word that fits in those descriptions. They have a lot of different examples in the book with mechanics associated with it. This is basically three descriptive units. There's your character type, which is the noun in that sentence, and that is glaive, nano, or jack. Then there's a second element, which is the adjective or character descriptor, which is something like charming or sneaky or intelligent or rugged. And the third keyword is your focus, which is the verb. So you might have a focus that is controls beasts or murders or fuses flesh and steel. And these three things come together to describe your character. So you could say that you are a tough glaive who fuses flesh and steel. You could be an intelligent nano who wields mental powers. You could be a stealthy jack that controls beasts. Each of these things can combine for just about any type of character. For example, you could have a nano who controls beasts, or a glaive who controls beasts, or a jack who controls beasts, and they all kind of have a different take on that. For example, a nano that controls beasts might have some sort of psychic ability to manipulate the minds of animals, whereas a glaive who controls beasts is kind of a big, maybe like an animal handler for like an evil menagerie or something like that, and a Jack might kind of split the difference, or just be somebody who has kind of an empathic understanding of how animals work, not necessarily something supernatural, but just really good at reacting to animals. So you can build just about any sort of character combination from these three words, and it's actually possible to have two different characters with very similar sort of builds in one campaign and have them be very different. Bruce Cardell is playing a character who is a glaive who fuses flesh and steel. His character is an older guy who has some sort of weird robotic exoskeleton implanted on his body. My character is a glaive who fuses flesh and steel, but all of his mechanics are internal, so he's got some sort of augmentation, he doesn't know what caused it, that sort of thing. It just allows you to have just about any sort of combo that you want, just in the same way that you could have in a D&D or Pathfinder game, you could have two different characters that are elven archers, and one elven archer might focus on, you know, doing trick shots, and the other one is the sniper, the deadeye sort of thing. That's what the type descriptor and focus of Numenera allow you to build with your character. And there are mechanics associated with that. If you have the tough keyword, then your character probably has more health. If you have the controls beasts, then you have a certain set of abilities that allow you to manipulate animals and so on, that sort of thing. So unlike many fantasy RPGs, Numenera is not about killing things and taking their stuff. Obviously, there are times where your characters might have to fight to defend their own lives or someone else's life, but that is not the focus of Numenera. The focus is that because there is so much in the worlds before left buried and mysterious, the focus is really exploration. It's about exploring the world, exploring the Numenera, exploring its effects on you, exploring your own abilities, and so characters are rewarded for exploration rather than killing. You can have a campaign session where the PCs are fighting things, but they might be, you know, fighting things as part of, there's a weird tribe worshipping an artifact that the PCs want, or they need parts to repair another device, and there are ancient robotic sentinels defending that device that they have to be dealt with on their way. But those fights are actually just obstacles to the true purpose, which is you want to go and explore and find things out. And there, obviously, you can have a character that's built very strongly for Marshall, but you want to have other aspects of your character as well, just to interact with the Numenera, talk to potential extraterrestrials, other humans, tribal humans, other explorers, all that sort of thing. There are a lot of ways that this sort of campaign is very different than how you play a standard RPG campaign. It's not that unusual for a campaign session to happen without any combat. And while combat is fun, just the fact that you might be discovering weird things and trying to figure out, you know, some old piece of technology is really the one of the more fun parts of the setting. You know that. But you can also have characters who are well-versed in the Numenera itself, and so you might have a nano who's like, oh yeah, this is a radio transmitter. That actually brings up a neat part of Numenera in that there are a lot of disposable items that characters are able to find, and they are deliberately disposable in that they only have one use, and that's to encourage players to have their characters experiment with these devices, trade them with each other, and find, you know, interesting ways to use them to defeat opponents or overcome obstacles, and because you know that they are expendable, and there's only a limited number that you can carry. It's actually based on your character's tier, which is equivalent to levels in other systems. You start at a first tier, you advance up to higher tiers. These objects called ciphers might be from the previous world, might be from three previous worlds, they might be radioactive, they might have weird chemicals in them. Short answer is that when they are brought into close proximity, they can be dangerous to you if you hold too many of them. And it's not until you've gained more experience that you learn how to handle more than a few ciphers at once. So you usually, if you're a starting character, only have about two or three ciphers that you can keep on you at one time. And you might be in a situation where you have dealt with a threat and found some sort of artifact, and the artifact itself is broken, but a knowledgeable character can take it apart and find a few pieces inside that might service some other function. Not necessarily the same function that it did when it was part of the original device. But, for example, if you had a computer, you could take apart the computer and use perhaps, you know, the transformer in it to augment some electronic device that you already have, boosting its effectiveness. If you have something that is the equivalent of a cell phone, you might be able to disassemble it and it wouldn't be able to make calls anymore, but you could make a recording device out of it, whether audio or video. And by kind of kitbashing these pieces out of salvaged items, you end up with, oh, I have five items and I can only hold two or three safely. So you'll set aside some of your ones that you don't really need right now, or you know that you, for your next task that you're going to be working on, there's going to be a fight coming up, and so this little device isn't going to have much of a use, but this thing is kind of like a bomb. I'm going to keep that, and then when we're done with that fight, if we don't have any more ciphers that we've picked up, we can go back to this base, dig up where we hid this stuff, and use them. So we talked for a while about the setting and about how characters work. I haven't talked yet about the rules. It's really interesting to me to see how Monty, who has, you know, been involved in D&D for a long time and was one of the key architects of D&D 3rd Edition. He's obviously worked on other games, but that's what he's best known for, is 3rd Edition D&D. D&D and Pathfinder are very rules-heavy, and it's very much a system where everything is spelled out for you. You know the difficulty class of this sort of check, and this different check always has a certain sort of number, and you have very tactical-based movement. And to look at Numenera, which is a strong shift away from that. It's a lot more free-form in that there are guidelines for how difficult certain things should be, but the GM is allowed to set the difficulty on his own for that sort of thing. It's just a lot more control in the hands of the GM to say that this obstacle is a certain level of difficulty. The really interesting thing in the Numenera system is that while it is a d20 based mechanic, and almost all your rolls are based on d20, basically you only use a d6, sorry, that's the cat again, you only use a d6 to have your character recover spent points from one of his ability pools. She's a very chatty cat, I'm sorry. But almost everything else is a d20. It's just you're rolling a d20, and unlike D&D or Pathfinder or most systems, the d20 roll is almost never modified by anything. So if you roll a 5 in the d20, that's your result. There are very few things that actually add to the number. Most things in the game alter the difficulty level, which alters the target number for what you need. So it's a very math-light game for the players. So if you are a sort of person just like adding up crazy numbers, it's a much easier game to learn from the player's standpoint, because all the player has to do is roll a die and tell the GM what the number they rolled is. And the GM is one who's setting the difficulty for that. Another interesting bit is that players make all the rolls. The GM doesn't make a roll. So if the player is attacking a monster or an NPC or whatever, the player is making an attack roll against a defense target number set by the power level of the monster or the NPC. If the monster is attacking a player character, then the player makes a defense roll against that attack, and the difficulty is set by, again, the power level of the monster. So the GM isn't making rolls to interact with the players, which is really, really strange, because in most games you're like, okay, well, it's the GM's turn to attack, all the monsters are making rolls. And by taking that away from the GM, it actually allows the GM to focus a lot more on the story and what's happening in the campaign and just creating an interesting atmosphere. And it's, I'm sure that it feels kind of disempowering to be a GM for Numenera the first time, because all the players are the ones taking actions, and your role as a GM is you're putting obstacles out there, but the players are reacting to it. Now there is a really neat mechanic that Monty put in here so that the GM actually has ways to intervene in the campaign, and it's called GM intrusion. Before I talk about GM intrusion, I want to talk about how experience points work in the game. It's not a game where you're gathering up hundreds of experience points and leveling up. You have a small number of XP, and the GM might award anywhere from 1 to 4 XP after a session, and you can use these experience points as a way to re-roll one of your own rolls and take the better result, have an ally re-roll one of their rolls. You can use it for temporary bonuses, like if you enter a weird alien crashed spaceship and you just want to say, you know what, I want to be just some, for some reason, I've got a good understanding of this spaceship, and so you could spend some XP to give yourself like a bonus on your rolls in interacting with that spaceship and knowing things about that spaceship. And after you leave that spaceship, it's gone. It's not as good as a I'm good with technology sort of bonus, which would be a more expensive sort of thing, but it's better than a I'm going to spend XP on this one roll sort of thing. This gaining XP mechanic is also used for leveling your character. When you have 4 experience points, you can spend those on 1 of 4 ways to permanently enhance your character. You can add some points permanently to your stat pool, you can gain training in a particular skill or advanced training in a skill, you can enhance your ability to use some of those ability score points, or enhance your ability to what they call using effort, which is putting an extra amount of your energy or physical power into accomplishing a task. Basically, you're kind of making a heroic effort to succeed at something that would normally be very difficult for you. So you can spend 4 XP on any of those things. And when you have done all 4 of those upgrades for a total of 16 XP, your character advances to the next tier. So you go from a first tier character to a second tier character. Related to XP is the idea of GM intrusion. So if you, for example, are in a combat and your character is attacking some sort of weird monster, the GM, for the sake of the story, can hand you 2 experience points and say, I'm using GM intrusion to make something happen. The edge of the cliff that you're standing on is very loose, you are off balance, and on your next turn, you are probably going to have to make some sort of roll to recover your balance and not fall, or stay impaired for another turn, or risk actually falling. So in giving you those 2 experience points, you get to keep 1 of them. You have to give the other XP to another player's character. And for whatever reason you want, you could give it to your best friend, you could give it to somebody who is short on XP and is always kind of unlucky, you could give it to somebody who has been doing a really good time of keeping the story on track, someone that's really funny, anything you want, but it's you're giving 2 XP and you get to decide who gets that other XP. So you are being rewarded for the GM adding a complication to the story. And it's kind of strange because a lot of people might react to that and say, but there's no reason why the ground under me is suddenly shifting, or there's no reason why my weapon is slipping out of my hand, or there's no reason why I might have tripped there. But the reason is that the GM is directing the story. And if it makes the story interesting, then that's a good thing. And far too many people who have been playing 3rd edition and Pathfinder have gotten used to the idea that if it's not in the rule books, it can't happen because the GM is constrained by the rules. And the truth is, the GM is the person who's building the campaign, and if the GM wants to say, hey, this thing works this way because I want to make a neat encounter based on that idea, that's totally okay. That's fine for the GM to have that power, because the GM is the one who isn't controlling the campaign, but is setting the goals for where the campaign can go. And Numenera actually takes that concept of the GM gets to drive the story and actually creates a hard physical mechanic in the game allowing the GM to do that. And that offsets the GM's lack of actual dice rolling. It also means that the GM never can be accused of fudging the dice because the GM isn't rolling any dice. But the GM can have a more difficult or less difficult sort of campaign by using intrusion more often or less often. But every time the GM uses intrusion, it ends up aiding the characters because it gives them experience points which they can use for advancement or for changing roles. Now, during this video, I've also been showing little bits of art from the book. It's a beautiful book. I had nothing to do with the art. I just think it's really cool. Kieran Yanner was the main artist for the book, and the layout was done by Sarah Robinson, who has worked on various video game magazines. She is art director at Paizo and is responsible for so much of the beautiful stuff that Paizo puts out. And Sarah has done a great job making the Numenera line just look really fantastic. So we've got examples of glaives and nanos and jacks and really scenic vistas that you could use to, you know, inspire a location for your own Numenera campaign. It's just a really beautiful book, and I recommend you take a look at it, even just from an artistic standpoint. If you aren't willing to take the plunge on getting the full Numenera book, because it is a $60 book, but it's totally worth it. It's a hardcover, it's full color. They actually were very smart and created a smaller player's guide that just has the slimmed down basic stuff that you need to know for playing your character. It has the basic rules for jacks, nanos, and glaives. It talks about the basic mechanic of how you roll a d20 and that there are different difficulty levels and how all this stuff is handled by the GM. It's a very inexpensive book. The link is in the description of this video. And if you want to get that in print or PDF, it's a much cheaper alternative. Basically, if you are the GM and you're going to be running a game, you definitely want to have the core book. And because it has all the rules in it, it has tons of example oddities and ciphers that, you know, technological items that the characters might find. Basically a bestiary of weird creatures of the ninth world. There's a description of the world, and it comes with a full color map. And one of the neat things that they did about the map is that there are large areas that are just open and unexplored. So it's not like every aspect of the setting is filled in for you. You can just fill it in however you like. And if you want to have some sort of weird flying city that's, you know, abandoned and about to crash, and it's over in this one particular part of the world that's threatening these villagers, that's your take on Numenera, on the Ninth World. And I think that's really cool. As I said earlier, I was a rules developer on this, so I'm biased about how I think the system is simple and elegant, and very easy to play, very easy to run. So I don't want to ramble on for any more than I already have, but definitely take a look at the Numenera book, or at least the player's guide. Go to montegoodgames.com. The link is also in the description of this video. Just take a look at all the previews that they've done about Numenera. If you're on Facebook, you can check out a lot more material there too. I am very, very proud to be part of this project in the small way that I was, and I wish Monty and Shauna all the best on all the future stuff that they're doing with Numenera. They've picked up some really great people to help create a full product line. They've got Charles Ryan, who's worked as a brand manager for Dungeons & Dragons. They now have Bruce Cordell, who has written some of the best 3rd edition and 2nd edition Dungeons & Dragons adventures. Now they've got the old Planescape Torment team is working on Torment Tides of Numenera, which is a video game. My friend Colin Lacombe, who is also a friend of Monty's, and they work together on Planescape. Colin is the story designer for this game. It's just, there's so much really cool stuff they're working on for Numenera, and definitely take a look at it and just have fun. That's about it for this video. And I actually have a very short video after this one that you should take a look at. Just take a look at it. It's a big, fun thing. In the meantime, good gaming. Have fun.